David McCullough is here. He has been called a master of the art of narrative history. He twice won the Pulitzer Prize and is recipient of the Presidential Medal of Freedom. He has written 11 books, including 1776 and John Adams. His latest piece of history is called The Wright Brothers. It tells the story of two bicycle mechanics from Dayton, Ohio, who taught the world to fly. I'm pleased to have my friend David McCullough back at this table. Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
This is the completion of a trilogy of high achievement.
That's exactly right. The first book was The Great Bridge, about the building of the Brooklyn Bridge. The second was my book about the building of the Panama Canal, The Path Between the Seas. Yeah. And now this. And all three of those extraordinary accomplishments took place in a handful of years, in the late 19th century into the first 10 years of the 20th century. And each in its own way was a major breakthrough without any historic precedent. But this one more obviously changed the world in no time, because man had never flown a motor-powered machine into the air before. And when that happened, it was clear to a few, but not to all, that this was one of the decisive turning points in history. What's so surprising, or many things were very surprising to me in writing the book, but what's so surprising is you sort of imagine, okay, they flew the first time at Kitty Hawk in 1903, and everybody realized this is terrific, right, and it would change the world. But it wasn't until 1908 that the world was ready to realize, yes, man can fly. Yeah. Because we had set our minds that that was impossible. And this so often happens with in many aspects of history and life, but seldom so dramatically.
What is it about the people that do this? They don't quit.
That's right. They do not give up. And I really think it also had something to do with where they came from. Ohio, Midwestern America. This is not to say that there are lots of other people from elsewhere that don't give up. Harry Truman never gave up. Midwestern American from very humble origins, as these people were. And they have purpose, Charlie. They have a purpose in mind. And it probably sounds like a bad pun. High purpose that they were determined to achieve no matter what. And every time either of them went up in one of their experimental planes and flights, he was risking his life. So it took tremendous courage and character. And surprisingly for me was to see to what extent their use of the English language was of a major importance in their success. They were raised by an itinerant minister father who insisted that they learn to use the language, both on paper and on their feet. And you read their letters and think that neither one ever finished high school, and it's humbling, their use of the language, their humor, their foresight, their everything. They grew up in a house that had no running water, no indoor plumbing, no electricity, no telephone, but it had books. Yeah. And the father insisted that they read, and not only read what he felt was of importance in fiction and history, but natural history and philosophy and the classics and everything, including the work of the famous agnostic Ingersoll, even though he was a Protestant itinerant preacher, the father. So he wanted a broad mind.
Wilbur was the dominant brother.
The dominant brother and a genius. Orville was very bright and very inventive, ingenious mechanically. But Wilbur really was the genius and the big brother. He was the leader. And yeah, it wouldn't have happened without both of them. Two heads were better than one, as it turned out. And the old idea that very little of consequence is ever accomplished alone, they are a good example of that.
When did they have the idea?
They had the idea that they could learn to glide.
To use wind.
to use the wind, to ride the wind. And they studied birds and soaring birds on the beaches
of North Carolina.
I
love that. I mean, just the idea of seeing them out there trying to flap their arms. And
the local people all thought they were wacko. Yes. Nutcakes from Middle West.
But they were studying.
Yes, they were studying the birds. And as Orville said, learning to fly by studying birds is like learning magic from a magician.
Yeah, they know how to fly. Yes.
So, and they figured it out. Nobody ever had. And then they had to fly. There were theorists who had very exciting and often very ingenious ideas, but they wouldn't fly. Wilbur once said that there are two ways to train a wild horse. One is to sit on the fence and study the horse, and then go to your comfortable chair in your living room and write your theory about how to train it.
And the other
a horse. The other way is to get on the horse and ride it. Exactly, they, as you know, were bicycle mechanics,
right.
And be exactly as if you said the only way you can learn to ride a bicycle is to ride a bicycle. Man. So they not only had the skill and the ingenuity and the genius to create a glider that would do more than any glider ever had, but they also had the courage to do it. And they were not defeated by failure. They learned from their mistakes. And that's
quit.
A marvelous lesson for all of us to learn.
I guess it was Orville who told a friend, he said, it isn't true to say we had no special advantage. The greatest thing in our favor was growing up in a family where there was always much encouragement.
Intellectual curiosity. Yeah. Exactly right. I think how we're brought up is more important than we realize. We put a lot of stress on education, as of course we should.
For better or worse.
Yes, of how you're raised. What were the manners you were taught? What were you taught about loyalty? What were you taught about telling the truth? What are you taught? Were taught about being kind to people? All of that begins at home, and the dinner table, and the conversations about behavior and aspirations. Their father was an exceptional teacher, and their sister, whose
Catherine
importance in this story, I'm very happy to say I've
uncovered.
Spent a lot of trouble, time, and effort bringing her front and center stage because she deserves it. She was bright. She was bossy. She was funny. She was opinionated. She had a temper. She could get wrathy, as she said, but she was always there when they needed her. And she was bright as can be. She's the only one of the group that went to college.
Does she remind you of Emily Roebling?
Yes, sir. And Abigail Adams, very strongly. And I think that the story would not have come out the way it did, had it not been for her. I think one of the joys of the work that I do is giving credit where credit's long overdue.
Yes.
And
find unrecognized characters.
Yes, and we need lessons in appreciation.
Yeah. A supporter of the Wright brothers compared the achievement to that of Christopher Columbus.
Yes.
You?
Yes. Absolutely.
So Columbus discovered the New World, and they discovered how to go to further worlds.
Well, think of this. You and I, everybody today, goes everywhere at 35,000 feet.
Right.
Last year at O'Hare Field in Chicago, 70 million people flew in and out of that one airport.
70 million.
Yes. And that 1903 wasn't all that long ago. I could have known Orville Wright. He didn't die until 1948. I would have been 15 years old. And he could have been that nice old fellow around the corner that was fun to talk to.
Right.
And it's a fraction of time, as history goes. This has all happened. You couldn't imagine a more dramatic change. And, of course, it hugely changed the horrors of warfare. And he lived to see jet propulsion. He lived to see rockets. It all happened very fast.
That's amazing.
Once they had got the key.